Okay, cool. So this will be an open house, so that's why I'm asking you to be louder. What's open house about? How many of you have been at an open house before? Okay, good. So I could go and say whatever I want about open house. No, so basically it's about you guys asking questions, and there'll be one guy moderating, that's me here today, and I'll be introducing these folks, and I'll start off with some icebreakers, ask few questions for them, and then you can start asking questions from whatever aspects of web, may it be server-side rendering, Node, React, Angular, Webpack, you name it, and we'll try to answer them, right? And we have Siddharth, Prateek, and Lakshya here. Siddharth is from Practo, Prateek is from Google, Lakshya is from Tribo, and I'm Hemanth, I'm from PayPal. So let's get started. Let's start with Prateek first. I heard you've been working on Workbox lately. Can you speak a bit about Workbox, what it is, and how is it better to compare to the other libraries we have?
I need to hold it closer.
Okay.
Cool. So Workbox is basically a JavaScript library, a service worker framework. If you guys would have already used SW Precache or SW Toolbox, these are like helper libraries for your service worker code. Just like you have DOM helper libraries, that these are helper libraries for service workers. So Workbox is the successor of this thing. Workbox allows you to precache your content, allows you to install runtime strategies, few of which I talk in my talk. And it brings a plug and play kind of architecture. So you can write your modules. For example, there's a module for background sync, there's a module for offline analytics. So you just have to plug that module in, for example, new offline analytics into Workbox and give it a route and it will start working. So SW Toolbox and Precache came with like predefined functionalities, and they were not really, great in extending that functionality. So with Workbox, we are trying to fix that, and we are trying to make the entire helper library in such a way that you can plug in more modules, you can write more modules, and then they work with way more ease than it was earlier.
Yeah. Thanks for the short description. And we have runners running around. That's why they're called runners, I guess.
Yeah.
So they have mics with them. So if you have any questions, you want to interrupt us, feel free. That's why it's called an open house. There's no format. It's not like questions at the last. You can't interrupt, nothing like that. You can interrupt anytime. You can just grab a mic and ask whatever you want. Feel free to do that. Now let's talk to Siddharth.
Sure. Hey.
Hey Siddharth, I heard like you've started a channel of yours on YouTube where you talk a lot of funny stuff. What's it all about?
I wouldn't say it's funny, but yeah, I try to stay updated with what's going on in JavaScript, and then I just record myself and put it on YouTube. That's it.
What's it called?
It's called the Siddharth KP Show. I didn't really think it through. Yeah, but yeah, it's just me. That's all.
That was an opportunity for you to market yourself. So.
Yeah. I think I've done that enough yesterday.
Yeah. At the React Con.
Yeah.
React too. Okay. It on to the Tribo guy. So most of us have read the Medium post about Tribo and what are the challenges they face, right? Now, could we just hear about one challenge that kind of didn't let you sleep for a week or something? Maybe a server-side rendering spike on the CPU or something like that?
Yeah, man, that's a really good question. I'm sure, I think not a lot of people, actually, how many of you do server-side rendering here in your applications? How many of you are actually React or Preact? Okay, that's fair enough. I'm sure it's pretty hard, right? Like, yes or no, can you scream it out? Okay. Yeah, I don't know, maybe. So what really happened was when we initially actually tried to do like an app shell model, and we tried to get that past our product manager, and he was like, no, we need SEO, I'm sorry. And we were like, okay, fine, let us figure this out. So basically what we tried to do was we did render to string, which is the documented way of doing it. And what we figured out was when we tried to go to prod, we can't handle scale because render to string, as Siddharth told yesterday at ReactFu, is that it's synchronous, right? And no matter how many instances you spin up, it's still synchronous. It's like all your requests are waiting in a queue. Trying to work around that, you actually want to do async rendering. And we actually use Rapscalion, which is not part of the blog post actually, because I'm going to write an entirely different thing about that soon. We actually went ahead and did async rendering to solve that. So what it actually does is it pushes it to the background thread, in a sense, I guess. I could be wrong, but it lets you scale up really easily. So that was actually one of the trickiest thing that actually I didn't sleep for, to be honest, to get it solved. Yeah.
Quick questions from audience, if any.
Questions?
Yep.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Narendra. Since this is the first question, I'll probably start off with the most controversial one, which is React licensing. I'd like to hear what's the fuss about, and do we need to use it, why, when we should not use it, and things around it. Thank you.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I love this question. I wasted a week over this question. So React's license is not your traditional open source license. It's not MIT, it's not Apache. It's their own custom BSD license, which is tricky. But essentially, like the layman version, or more like what I understood version, was that if you ever get into a patent war with Facebook, right? So if your startup grows big enough and you have excellent patents that Facebook wants, but it does not buy you out, instead illegally uses your patents, you cannot sue them because you have been benefiting from using React, which is something that they created. So you can use it for free as much as you want until you want to sue them for a patent war, then you can't. Then you have to basically spend some time, refactor React out, and then you can sue them again, right? And so a lot of people have put their own expensive lawyers on this, right? Like PayPal. And what they found is that, yeah, like PayPal is pretty cool with it. They can use it because Facebook is not stealing their patents, so it's cool. And if they do, they have the money to like sue them. And that's fine, yeah. That's what Twitter, Google do. Everyone uses it, so I guess we can use it. I'm not suing Facebook, so it's all chill.
One quick addition to that. If at that day I pull in Preact with Preact Compact, does that still work?
Preact Compact, no, because you still have React. You're just kind of replacing it on build. But if you run a code mod and replace React with Preact, then you're cool. Then yeah, go so ahead.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
My question is to Lakshya. So Tribo, the website, the first visit times and metrics are really important, right? So could you tell us something about, you know, what challenges you faced to get to those metrics, and like what is the most impactful solution you had for that?
Hey man, good question. So one of the things that we actually had a really difficult time doing was trying to get time to interactive kind of to a reasonable rate, because the accepted rate is below 5 seconds on a slow 3G network. Even when you do things like code splitting and things like that, you have to be really careful of how much you actually split, because if you split so much that everything is asynchronous, then you're practically wasting time trying to get all your async code in. One thing that actually helped us was HTML streaming, where you basically push the head tag in first with all your preload scripts for all your tags, for all your main vendor and things like that, and then so that when the rest of the server-side rendered thing, for us it was server-side rendered, so that when the rest of the server-side rendered request came in, most of your scripts are kind of already in the cache. So when the requests are made, you kind of benefit from that. That keeps your time to interactivity down. Apart from that, first paint and meaningful paint is another important metric. Most of that was kind of solved during CSS chunking, because it's not just code splitting on your JS, right? If you just split your JS and be like, okay, I'm going to serve a massive CSS bundle, your CSS is going to be the bottleneck. And if you all know, CSS is actually render blocking, right? So you're going to block your render completely and the user's not going to see anything. What you want to do is try to split JavaScript and CSS based on your chunks, if you actually are doing splitting based on chunk. One challenge we actually faced that Kanav spoke about yesterday was trying to make a different entry point so that extract text plugin kind of brings out the CSS. There's a different plugin called extract CSS chunks. So if you just do import calls in your JavaScript, it'll kind of split your JS and CSS for it. So that's really helpful. So you don't have like a bloated entry file and things like that. So what you want to do is during server-side rendering, get your route, throw in the critical inline styles for that particular route so you're not render blocking at all. And that'll actually help your first meaningful paint. For us, one important kind of like a hack, I guess, was trying, we have like a big image right on top in our viewport. We preload that as well. So there are multiple things you can do it, but don't preload everything, right? There's this quote from The Incredibles that says, if everyone's a superhero, no one is. So it's the same thing. If you preload everything, that means you're saying, yeah, import, everything's important, whereas nothing is at that point. So be careful. It's kind of more on situational basis. Based on your app, try to read more is what has actually been helpful for me.
So more questions or some experiences you want to share while working on PWAs, some interesting situation you got into or something interesting, some library you found out? Yeah? No? Okay. So
I see a few folks from Flipkart here who have already built the Flipkart light and made the revolution of PWA. Probably they could add in something.
So how is the streaming working for you? I mean, so when it throws a 400 or a 500, how do you tell to SEO?
Sure. That's a good question. So the first thing we went with, because we were kind of in a rush, was, hey, we don't care, because that's what everyone does, right? You kind of care about it after the fact, but no. So what we try to do is we kind of do the route matching beforehand, before we even send the streamed head part. The route matching does take some time, so you kind of know what's happening at that point itself. But in between, if the stream breaks, I don't have like a good solution for that right now. So that should be kind of, you know, something that we should tackle as well. I don't have like a perfect solution for it. You're right. Because once the, yeah.
So, I mean, streaming doesn't really work. I mean, this is the talk last year we gave on the same stage where we tried with the streaming. It added a lot of goodness in terms of the rendering performance and everything, but it failed miserably at SEO. Google started in indexing all the 500 pages. So we had to turn off and we had to put as a SEO completely on server. So it doesn't work, we're still figuring out. So that's one piece of advice, like you need to take care of SEO if you're really looking to build on a desktop. But on a mobile, I don't think we need to do any server-side rendering. So it's still not clear.
Kind of like on the same base, but there is kind of a new approach that you could try. Google actually released a project called Rendertron. So what they basically do is it's a rendering service. And they have middleware. So if you have Express or Koa or something like that, they have a middleware that kind of, if all your search bots, if the requests are from search bots, it kind of sends it off to Rendertron. So Rendertron can render your pages beforehand or keep it, or render it right then and then serve server-side render pages to your search bots specifically. But to users, you can kind of send it to your stream. So that way you can kind of work around that, if that helps. No comments.
We had a question this side.
Yeah. So just wanted to ask this question that React 16 or React Fiber has this new Fiber reconciler. So we have seen the shift changing from watchers in Angular to the virtual diffing in React. And now this is, so how will it be pan out? And will it be like adopted now by other frameworks, or is it good enough, this prioritization of task, request new, idle callback, and stuff like that? Some of the comments from you.
Sure, yeah. So to answer your question that will this become a trend and other frameworks will adopt it, I think they already have. So Vue.js, even Angular's new thing, which kind of depends on Angular 4, which depends on components, right? All of these guys tried to do their own implementation of the virtual DOM. So they might not have the same reconciler as React, but everyone has a fake virtual DOM and the real DOM. and all of the manipulations happen to the virtual DOM first and then to the real. I think Polymer also does the same thing now. It has a shadow DOM or a, right?
Yes. So for what it's worth, like every other solution out there is trying its best to like use request idle callback to its max, because that is one API that gives you windows of free CPU cycles and tells you that, hey, you can do your extra work here. So like, I am not completely sure about Polymer, but yes, Vue is exactly what is working on this particular thing.
Yeah. What happens with Polymer there is we have the shadow DOM concept, not really like a virtual DOM thing. It's basically a DOM which is, as the name says, it is shadowing, which has all the properties of the DOM, but until you attach and render it, it doesn't really show up there, right? It's almost like virtual DOM, but there's no diffing happening as such, right?
Fair enough. And I guess web components also depends on shadow DOM, right? And if web component, if and when it picks up, right, and that uses shadow DOM, I think that will be the standard way we build for like browsers. That would be the only thing we do. Yeah. And frameworks wouldn't even do it. Frameworks would be an abstraction on top of it.
Yeah. So there was a saying that said like all the programmers are telegraphers of 21st century. You know, so we'll all be dead with something which is much better. All this race will be kind of obsolete very soon.
Vinci? Hey, I had a question on, have you guys experimented? I know a couple of people, I think Flipkart and Housing were trying AMP to PWA. So how successful have those experiments been? And even from an SEO standpoint, have they been good enough for you guys?
Do we have someone from Flipkart who can answer that?
Yeah, who have implemented it, have done it.
Hey, so first things first, AMP and SEO are not related. This is something all the SEO folks says, but these two are not related. Again, personally, I don't like AMP. It's still there in PWA. If you reverse it, it's there, right? So, but yeah, that's a different debate. But it's a pain in terms of like you need to build a different version of your website, and you need to carefully craft it. So we personally have like two versions of the website, where one is for PWA, one is for non-PWA, like UC web and all that. On top of that, adding one more is a complex. So we kind of paused it for now. But anyone have any success stories? Would like to hear from that.
Right. So and there's an interesting addition that I'll say, right? You say you maintain two versions, right? What I've been doing in the past is when I server render my React components, right, like whole HTML string, right, I just serve that. And then there are just tiny modifications between the AMP semantics and HTML semantics. And that becomes my AMP version. And then it's just like uninteractive version, which goes to AMP. And then when I serve it to users, like non-AMP version, I let React DOM come into the client and then rehydrate it. So we maintain one version and get to do both, right? To contradict your first thing, when you say all the marketing people say that AMP is for SEO, right? You're right, it's not really for SEO, but it is for traffic, right? Like Google clearly cheats and prioritizes AMP content, and then that's what marketers want, right? They want traffic. So maybe like you don't get SEO points, but you get money. Like that's what people want. Oh, definitely, yeah, yeah. You're essentially saying everything, I will keep a rendered static copy and serve that to everyone. Yeah, it's definitely a pain, but traffic.
It like you have a React renderer which takes in React components and like output AMP components, which you have mapping for every component or every every tag of yours, is it? Oh, okay.
So it's the same React render to string, but instead of an image tag, I just create an image component, and depending on the context, it either spits out an image or spits out an AMP hyphen image. Right, and then we do, so basically in your component library, you create it for both context specific, and then you use the same thing to render everywhere.
So there is a debate of free and open web versus AMP consuming it altogether, and probably WordPress has AMP enabled by default to get the content rendered faster, at least make it feel it's fast. So it's still debatable. Yeah, it's pretty open for all the controversies.
I guess Ghost also started giving AMP out of the box. So many frameworks are.
Yeah.
Hello. Yeah, I had a query about this thing, Shadow DOM. So what I read about Shadow DOM slightly was that it's something that's already inbuilt into the browser, it's a power that was unlocked by Polymer or web components. So is it something like that?
It's not like the power that was unlocked by Polymer or somebody. It's more of a spec. So with web components, you version 1.0, the spec reads about what Shadow DOM is. So it's part of that. So for a web component, there's this custom elements, there's Shadow DOM altogether paired up to form the spec. So it is not like it was already there and unlocked. It is part of the process. Like when it started Polymer, it feels more like a trend, which was like a fallback till we have custom elements on the components on the web. But now it's becoming more of a good library. Yeah, as spec is stabilizing, right?
Hi, I had a service worker question. The gentleman there had asked in the previous session about XSS vulnerabilities with the service worker. Did you want to add anything on that, and if we could do anything to prevent that from happening? Any
so I heard that my colleague Douglas Crawford said that. I say he's my colleague because he works at PayPal. But I didn't really read any specific article saying that what are the vulnerabilities that a service worker has. If you see what could be the possible entry points, we are already on HTTPS, so you can't really spoof some network request and get in. And I don't really see a possible entry points. Probably it might be
so
in terms of
so since like the very first baseline of getting a service worker to work is HTTPS, that rules out a lot of by mistake vulnerabilities. But then service worker again is a proxy that sits like outside your code, and you pretty much have the power to code it up, screw it up. And if you are modifying your requests inside service workers, that is one of the major things that come into my mind that you have to be careful with. If you are modifying your outgoing request there, or and using the incoming response as is, that is one thing that you might have to be careful with.
Hello. Up here.
Yes. Before a year, if any one of you remember, there was this interesting incident happened. So one of the developer actually, because of some brand infringement or some of the legal issues, he actually unpublished many of the modules.
Left pad.
Yeah. So actually, I couldn't follow that article much. So after that, has NPM changed its policies or made it strict or something? So if you can iterate the incident and answer my question.
We miss you, left pad.
So what happened was NPM, when it was a younger registry, when it was not as mature as the other language ecosystems, it had a pretty open, unpublished policy. So what happened, this guy who created Leftpad also created another package called Kik, K-I-K. And Kik is also like a huge company. So they said, we want this package, we own the rights to it, right? So you shouldn't use it. And so those guys talked to the developers. They told him that please don't use this name because we own the copyrights. He said, but this is open source, right? And if you don't have it already, if I took it, it's mine. And then so Kik people got NPM involved, and NPM kind of had to make a decision, right? Who do we support in this case? They supported Kik the company, right? And they took the rights from the developer and gave it to this guy. The developer got pissed, which is fair, and he unpublished all of his packages, right? Leftpad was one of the packages that he had, which I think, which big project used it? Babel used to use it, right? And everyone uses Babel. And which just meant that anytime you do npm install Babel, it wouldn't work because one dependency just disappeared.
And Leftpad was just a one-liner, basically. But that's the power of free and open source. And
But now npm's policy has changed. It changed immediately after that. I think you get a 24-hour window to force unpublish your packages. After that, even if one single person starts using your package as a dependency, you can't unpublish it. You can deprecate stuff, release new versions, but you can't go back on what you've already created. So in retrospect, all the other package managers already had it, pip and gem already do this stuff. NPM didn't do it, but then now they do. Now they're much more mature.
One of the funny incidents on that is when you have two registries, so you have a private registry and the public, and if you have not pointed it properly, and you sometimes end up publishing your private modules to the public repo, and then you have to write a mail to npm saying, hey, this is a private repo, please deprecate it. And like you say deprecate it and probably take out everything, all the code out of it, and make just add a package JSON and say nothing here, move on, kind of a thing, right? So
yeah, guys, up here, I have a question. We are talking a lot about progressive web apps and PWA everything. There's one still question which lingers to all of us. We are talking a lot about a B2C application, but in B2B, still everything, a lot of companies, traditional companies like life sciences, manufacturing, runs on Internet Explorer. So what are your strategies to get things going on Internet Explorer, say for i10, i11? I mean, what do you think would be the fallbacks to see these things working in that environment also?
Fallback would be Edge, probably.
Yeah, just a moment. I have an announcement to make. People who are interested in the app security clinic, it's starting downstairs at 4 o'clock, which is 2 minutes from now.
And we have 4 minutes left on this session.
Yes. Make a choice.
So, to be honest, what he said, right? Just tell them to install Chrome or Edge or something, right? And this problem is going away slowly because Windows does not support IE anymore. Like if you buy a new Windows machine, it doesn't come with IE, it comes with Edge.
But
that's my best answer.
Yeah.
So one thing is like, one way is like you can obviously go and say that please download Chrome. Though I would like suggest you to like defer it as much as possible. You can have a baseline that, hey, these browsers, we support all browsers because web, because that's how we have been known.
Something
for.
Like looks best in Chrome with
or
resolution.
At least like give us like, okay, last three versions. That's most what most companies do. But like just saying and closing, I know there will be some shade thrown on me on this because Google comes up now every now and then and do this. But yeah. Like just completely blocking the browser altogether and not doing anything should be like your last minus one resort, unless it's up to your neck. But you can always like IE10, like does a pretty fine job with maybe not with all the APIs, and which is what progressive enhancement is about. But yeah, like you can still support fewer version of it.
Yeah, so there's one scenario.
We have
like
one.
Just to add to this conversation.
Sorry, we'll have to cut you because other people are waiting for their questions. And this is one last question by this gentleman. You can talk to them offline.
To add on, whatever fun we make about IE, but we need to owe Microsoft for XHR, because Microsoft was the company which gave us XHR. Like, but still we call it as XML HTTP request. It's not really. It wasn't really XML anymore. Like probably we have fetch now, but still that the idea was great. And there was something called as HTA, if someone remembers what HTA was. So it's called as like HTML applications. Like you could still do it today. You could rename your HTML file as HTA and open it on a Windows machine. It would open up like an Electron app. That was done long back.
PWAs of 1990s.
Yeah, 90s, 80s or something like that, right? So. And Edge was the first browser to implement class and tail recursions, right? So it's doing a good stuff. So let's not have a war against ourselves. Every browser has something good and bad. Let's take the good parts.
Yeah. Hi. So my question is a bit different. Like we in our company, we don't deploy application on public domains. So we have the application on client side deployed over there, and they're using as internal apps. And we have large data which gets downloaded on the browser, and we need to display that. So the problem we face that we used Angular and Knockout, and it took a lot of time to render the screens. Okay, so many a time we used to render the HTML data on the server and then render it on the on the browser. So what approaches would you suggest that what is better? Like we don't care of SEO or something because it's inside their application and it's not in public domain. So is it better to render on server because it still takes time? And if we use the Angular or the Knockout, it's still taking longer time to render, and we can't go away with showing the data. We need all the data on the browser.
I would kind of vote for a mixture of both. Like you could have your initial rendering and a push from the server, and then the rest takes care on the client, so that the perceived performance will be better. The user
and apart from the libraries, are there any tweaks with the browser or any other like service workers or something like that which can be done?
Streams. So. You can obviously use streams, which are not really there for all the browsers at this point of time. But this is, streams is something you should definitely check in. It is like made for this kind of scenarios and a lot more. B, you can always do like server renders some portion of your data, maybe like first fold of your screen, and then just send that data to be client rendered on the client side. Correct me if I'm wrong, the Flipkart peeps, Nagaraju? Yeah, we still do first fold server-side render for Flipkart and then the rest of it on client, is it? Yeah. So maybe something you can do like that.
Thank you.
Time's up. Yeah. Awesome. Thank you, guys. Hope you like the open house. And if you have any queries, you can just tweet at us. And like we have our Twitter handles on #JSU. You can find there and we'll try to answer. If not, we'll get in touch with the right people who can solve the issues. Thank you.